Good morning from Western Avenue. I am Bo Mircha, Associate Pastor at First Pres, and on behalf of all of us here at First Pres, I want to say welcome on this special Sunday to worship. We have prepared a video with a few people, very special people, and we hope that they will put a smile on your face as we're getting ready to worship this Sunday. Let us worship. The Lord is with you.
Good morning, First Pres. I'm just sitting here enjoying some hammock time and a little at-home beach that my sister made. I'll go ahead and show it to you in a minute, but all you need is some sand, a bucket, and water. It may not look like much, but man, I feel like I'm right on the lakefront.
Go.
Hi, First Press.
Don't you want? Had you too?
Good morning, First Press.
I invite you to rejoice with me as we begin our time of worship today. We will give thanks to you, O Lord, with our whole heart. We will tell of your wonderful deeds. We will be glad and exalt in you. We will sing praises to you, O Most High. Please pray with me. We celebrate you, O God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. We need your healing power, so bring us into your wholeness as we worship you this day. We make this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Let us sing and rejoice as we worship now.
Thank you.
for children, so please bring the children close so that they can see this time with children. I want to introduce you to a new friend we have at our house, a new pet. His name is Winston. He's 3.5 month old kitty, and he's still growing. And here's a picture of him. He's looking at me. I think he's wanting to get up and play. Here's another picture. He's sleeping in my arm. He's my buddy. And here's a clip of some playtime with Winston. He's going in and out of his bed as I shake it and we play together.
Yep, get in there. No, get in there. Get in there. Yeah, there you go. Get in there. Where you go? Where's Winston? Where is he? There he is. There he is. There he is. Yeah. Ouch. There you go. Boom. 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 He's in there. He's in there.
Aren't pets special? And pets are a lot of fun. And you know that if you have a pet, but you also know that pets take a lot of hard work. We have to feed them, we have to get their food, we have to provide water for them, we even have to change their litter box if they're a kitty, we have to clean up after them when they make all different kinds of messes or knock things down. Pets take a lot of work. Yes, pets are a lot of fun, but they also are a lot of responsibility. And as I look at following Jesus, I see the same kind of thing. There's a lot of fun and special times and relationships to following Jesus, but there's also a lot of responsibility. Jesus says to us, I no longer call you a servant, but you are my friend. And Jesus tells us he wants us to live in his joy and know a deep happiness. And so he brings us together with other people in the church so we aren't alone and we have many special times of fellowship and ministry and mission together. But there's also a responsibility to following Jesus. Jesus says to us, follow me, listen to me, obey me. If you love me, you will keep my commandments to love God and to love others. And Paul, in the book of Ephesians that we're studying this summer as a church, says, I am a servant of the gospel of Jesus. In other places, he says, I'm a slave of Jesus. I'm a servant of Jesus. And you see, Paul listens to what Jesus tells him to do. Paul goes all over the world, traveling to many different places, meeting all kinds of new people. But sometimes Paul just gets worn out and gets tired doing all the things that Jesus wants him to do. And sometimes Paul suffers for Jesus, and Paul calls himself a prisoner of Christ Jesus because sometimes Paul was put in prison for preaching the good news and the love of Jesus because there were some people that didn't like Jesus and didn't like his message. So kids, I hope you remember that following Jesus is a lot of fun. It brings us together with very special people, and we have special times together in fellowship and being God's people. But following Jesus is also a lot of responsibility. There's hard work to following Jesus. We need to listen to Jesus and do the things that he tells us to do. Please pray with me. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you love us deeply and you bring us into a relationship with you and you give us your joy and many special fun times with your people and with you. But we also know that you call us to follow you and to listen. So, Lord Jesus, help us to listen to you in all things. We pray it in your name. Amen.
Good morning, First Pres. Carissa here with community announcements. Number one, teens, remember, we have a water fight today, 1 p.m. in the church parking lot. I'm asking that you wear clothes. You don't mind getting wet? And definitely bring a towel to sit on the way home. You can dry off with it too, but trust me, you'll want it to sit on. And I'm asking parents that you come join us. You can play or not, but help me keep track of the social distancing, okay? I would really appreciate it. Now, we have a very special announcement up next. I cannot wait for you to meet her. She's a friend of mine. So, kids, I'll see you at 1. Oh. Hey, Cam here. I am so excited to meet you guys. I have it on good word from your friend, Pastor Bo, that at the end of July, you're going to be joining me on the railroad at a very special VBS. I can't wait. Make sure you register today because, for the first time ever, we're going to come to you. That's right. VBS will be right at your home, so the railway is coming your way. It's going to be a great time to learn about Jesus, do fun activities, and I promise we will always be singing and dancing. So, register today online, and I'll see you the last week of July. I better get back to work. I'll see you then. Wow, that cam girl seemed like a lot of fun. I can't wait for VBS to start. Now, we have a couple more announcements to go through. So, first one is July 15th. This Wednesday, we are going to have our own tailgate dinner party. I'm gonna put information at the bottom so you can see all of it. I just wanted you guys to know that you can bring your own food, you can order from Jacob Henry Mansion, and you can find all that details and information on our website. So be sure to check it out. And you can either sit in a chair like this or deck out your hatchback. I haven't decided which one I'll do yet, but I know I'll be there and I'm very excited. One more message from our good friend Kendall Friss on Bags of Love.
Hi everyone, thanks for joining us on Packing Day. We are in my garage, which doubles as the pantry since the pandemic began in March. We are currently packing the bags that are going to be distributed here momentarily. Thanks to your generous donations, we were able to continue the mission and all of our community partnerships. So donations have not slowed down, and that's an amazing thing. I think it's really important to remember those in need during this time. So we start over here with some drinks, juice boxes, granola bars. We also have entrees, fruit, vegetables, whole boxes of crackers here. We have some sweets over here, sandwich crackers, canned meat and fish. We also have a nice option for socks, tissues, and plastic silverware. So once we get to the end of the line, we have a full bag. And then we just go over here and fill it in the Jeep. I'd like to give a quick shout out to Burkhoff's, who is generous enough to donate brown paper bags so that we can continue the mission and go spread the love. Thanks, everyone.
Jesus, whose voice the winds obey, what manner of man is this? Who with a word can calm the angry sea and still the tempest in my breast? Who is this man opens sightless eyes and gives my longing spirit light? At whose command the multitude is fed, who fills me with the bread of life? He is my shepherd, he calls me by my name, bids me rest safe within his fold, and I will stand as witness of his everlasting love, my Lord, my God, the shepherd of my soul. Who is this Jesus the world has set at naught, this healer whose power I know? At whose command the lame rise up and walk, whose mighty hand has made me whole. Who is this man who seeks me when I stray, who hears my every anguished cry, who bears my grief, who suffers all my pain, and returns to me unmeasured joy? He is my shepherd. Safe within his fold, and I will stand as witness of his everlasting love, my Lord, my God, the shepherd of my soul.
Good morning. Let us pray. Lord God, help us to know your ways and teach us your paths. Lead us in your truth and teach us, for you are the God of our salvation. For you we wait all day long. Through Christ our Lord, amen. This morning's reading is from the book of Joshua, chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. This is taken from the Living Bible. After the death of Moses, the Lord's disciple, God spoke to Moses' assistant, whose name was Joshua, the son of Nun. And he said to him, "Now that my disciple is dead, you are the new leader of Israel. Lead my people across the Jordan River into the promised land. I say to you what I said to Moses, wherever you go will be part of the land of Israel, all the way from the Negev desert in the south to the Lebanon mountains in the north, and from the Mediterranean Sea in the west to the Euphrates River in the east, including all the lands of the Hittites. No one will be able to oppose you as long as you live, for I will be with you just as I was with Moses. I will not abandon you or fail to help you. Be strong and brave, for you will be a successful leader of my people, and they shall conquer all the land I promised to their ancestors."
In worship, we celebrate the greatness, the goodness, and the graciousness of God. And when we give our tithes and our offerings, we say thanks to God and we support what God is doing in the world. There are a number of ways that we can give at First Presbyterian Church. We can give using envelopes and mail in our offerings. We can give using the website, going to the Giving tab. We can give by electronic transfer by talking with our treasurer, Tracy Norris, and setting that up. We can also give in live worship when we come. May you know the hope and joy of the Lord Jesus Christ as you give of your financial resources to support Christ's work and ministry in our world. Now let us continue our worship.
As we approach God's word this morning. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may hear your word with joy. Amen. Today's reading is from Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. We're going to read chapter 3, verses 1 to 13. Listen to God's word. This is the reason that I, Paul, am a prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. For surely you have already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I wrote above in a few words, a reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. In former generation, this mystery was not made known to humankind, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That mystery, that is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of his power. Although I am the very least of the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of the boundless riches in Christ, and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church, the wisdom of God in its rich variety might now be made known to the rulers and authorities and in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and in confidence through faith in him. I pray, therefore, that you may not lose heart over my sufferings for you. They are your glory. This is the word of the Lord for God's people. Over the last few weeks, we had looked at Apostle Paul's letter to Ephesians in the context of essential faith, extraordinary grace. Today, I'd like for us to continue to think about that ordinary grace as a grace that unites. As we approach the text today, it's very easy for us to see in these 13 verses some of the themes that really speaks about Paul's faith, about his beliefs, about what motivates him to do all the things he's doing. You know, you hear very clear the theology of Christ the Lord. You hear very clear that adoption motif, that Gentiles have been adopted in God's family. You hear and you see the fact that God is present with his people all along the way, and all this is for the salvation of those around. It's very important to kind of keep those things in the back of our minds as we approach the text. But I would also like to spend a little time understanding the letter's cultural and historical context. You see, Apostle Paul, at the time of this writing, he's in Rome, he's in prison, he's in a home arrest, and he's waiting trial before the emperor. How he got to Rome, it's a long story, and it's complicated in many ways. But the important thing is to remember that in the book of Acts, chapter 24, the high priest and some elders and lawyers come to the king and bring charges against Paul. And they accuse him of being the ringleader of the sect of Nazarene and stirring up riots and defiling the temple. Now, these are some very serious accusations. As we read the book of Acts, we see Paul defending himself before the king. And finally, there is a point where he says, I am a Roman citizen. The only way we can solve this is if I prove my innocence before the emperor in Rome. So this brings him to Rome, waiting trial and awaiting trial to appear before Nero. Now, let's talk a little bit about house arrest at the time. He had to pay for his accommodation, and he had to follow very strict regime, right? He was handcuffed, chained to a Roman soldier this whole entire time. But this has not stopped him from writing to all the churches that he established, he planted along the way. He didn't stop him to receive people, to preach the gospel. Just because he's chained and waiting trial doesn't change who he is. Even more so, he finds that to be a joy, to be a reason that God, to be a reason for God's glory, a reason for his life to go and proclaim the gospel. He writes this epistle chained day and night to a Roman guard, as I said. And as he writes, he is proud to say, I am a prisoner of Christ. When it comes to the understanding of who Paul is, this is an essential point to understand, because it speaks about identity. It speaks about personhood, and ultimately about Paul's call in life. You see, he is not saying, I am a prisoner of injustice. I am a prisoner of misunderstanding. I am a prisoner of the high priest. I am a prisoner of Nero. He doesn't say any of that. He says, I am a prisoner of Christ's love, a prisoner of Christ's grace. Paul sees his current situation from the perspective of his most significant achievement, being part of Christ's ministry. A point of view makes the whole difference in the world, right? The way we look at things makes a huge difference. There is a story about Sir Christopher Wren, who was in charge of building St. Paul Cathedral in London. One day he's inspecting the construction site, and he sees a man and he asks him, what are you doing? The man says, I'm cutting stone. You know, they tell me how big to cut it, and I just go and cut it. He sees another man and asks, what are you doing? The man just replies, I'm just earning my pay. He runs into a third man and asks, man, what are you doing? After a short pause, the man replied, I am helping Sir Christopher Wren build the St. Paul Cathedral. You see, the way we see ourselves changes the whole narrative, right? The way we see our place in God's story changes the whole narrative. And Paul knew that down deep. All he was, all his life, and everything that he was going to be were rooted and connected to Christ Jesus. This is where grace that unites starts, in finding and defining our identity in Christ. In Christ, we all become one. This is the very essence of the gospel. Paul understood that message as God's mystery hidden along the way in the story of God. Listen one more time to these words. The mystery of Christ was not made known to the Son of Man in other generation, as it has now been revealed to His Holy Spirit, to His holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ through the gospel. For the first 3.5 years, the church in Jerusalem continued to be very much a Jewish church. They followed the same tradition established thousands of years before that. They continued to practice the holiness laws. They continued to practice circumcision. And part of it is because they didn't understand that God's grace in Christ Jesus was for all the people. You see, God did separate Jews from Gentiles. That is very clear in the Old Testament. And not because one was better than the other. All were sinners in God's eyes. The Israelites were chosen to become that beacon of light in the whole world. A place where all the people of the world will come and discover God's grace, learn God's law, and be transformed the same way that Moses was when he encountered the burning bush in the desert. And yet, the church in Jerusalem failed to see that until that time that the gospel found its place in the heart of so many Gentiles. The message of the gospel resonated with the Gentiles in a way that was amazing. And it is at this point that the church in Jerusalem, the apostles, face a crisis where they are confronted with defining who they are. They are confronted with the question, what are our values? How do we deal with these pesky Gentiles? It is at that time that grace and forgiveness come together, and with the understanding, with the revelation that God has for the church at the time, opens the doors wide for the Gentiles. And in part of it is because that forgiveness and grace become the identity of the church in Jerusalem. Not the traditions, not the practices. It is the grace and the forgiveness that become center to who they are. You see, their identity is not anymore connected to physical boundaries or traditional understanding. Their identity is now rooted in Christ. And that is a very important point. It is in Christ that we are able to stand before God as forgiven sinners, welcomed in the family of Abraham, adopted sons and daughter, saints marching towards a heavenly kingdom. It's all in that identity. As Paul writes from Rome, he reminds those that receive his letter to remember their identity in Christ before anything else. As believers, we are confronted with that decision every day, in all circumstances, in all the things we come to face. From this identity, we look at those around us and see them as precious in the eyes of God. Out of that understanding of grace and forgiveness, we can say, God has a plan for your life. No matter who you are, your skin color, nationality, family background, or economic status, God has a plan for you. Out of that identity of forgiveness and grace, we can rise above our circumstances. We can stand before anyone and anything, no matter of our upbringing, skin color, or nationality. Speaking these words, it's a very personal thing to me. I came to this country as an immigrant, born and raised in a different country with different traditions and different views of the world. Along the way, my accent, the way I do things or seeing the world, had me looked from outside in, made me feel like an outsider. And yet I stand before you today because I am first and foremost a child of God, someone that sees the world as one. That is what gave me the confidence to do what I do and continue to minister the way I do, to be who I am in this new country that is now my home. I am proud to say that today I stand before you as an American. I see myself as a son of this country that opened its doors and hearts to me. Over the past 18 years, I have found grace. I have met people who welcomed me into their lives and made me feel like home. I am so grateful for the grace that I encounter. And yet I know there is so much more. There is so much more grace to be given and to be found. You see, if we, the people of God, limit the understanding of God's grace, we stop people from seeing that grace. But if we are to speak about who we are in Christ, that will empower, that will open the doors for other people to see God's grace. Recently, I was reading an opinion post in one of the papers that comes across my desk, and the author of the post was trying to shame the church in speaking about the fruits of the Spirit. He wrote that in the context of the church is complicit to the political environment of what's going on today, and the reality is that there is less of the fruit of the Spirit in the church and there is more of the fruits of the flesh. I have to tell you that I did not take that article with too much grace. In part because I believe there is a time for the church to stand up and speak what is right. This is a time for the church to stand for love, for mercy, for patience, for kindness. And I believe that it is our time to speak about our identity, to speak about what makes us the church of Christ. Identity defines who we are and what we do. We don't talk too much about it. You know, sometimes we take things for granted. I am a Christian for so many years. I've been doing this all my life. What if we are to speak as the people of grace that we are, as the people that are shaped by grace and called to extend that grace? If you want, we are shackled to grace, the same way Paul was shackled to that Roman soldier. We are prisoners of grace, and we should be proud of it. We should let that be our identity, the thing that defines us. Early in the service, we had read the words of Joshua from the book of Joshua, where God is telling the people of Israel, be brave and courageous. Go into the promised land. I will be with you. I will walk with you. But you have to be brave and courageous. Be strong, dedicated to God's law and teaching. I want to believe and I want to say that this is a time for the church to be brave and courageous. This is a time for the church to stand up for God. Just as the church in Ephesus, when they hear about Paul being in prison, we can lose heart, lose our focus, and ultimately revert to the old self, letting fear and division rule our hearts. Or we can stand as a testimony to God's grace, even in the most uncertain times. I want to encourage you this day to find your identity in Christ. May we all say, I am a prisoner of Christ. I am a prisoner of grace. I am a prisoner of a grace that unites. Would you pray with me? Lord, we're thankful for your grace, and we pray that in everything that we are and do, we'll be your servants. Help us to see the world from that perspective, from your love, and the way you reach and continue to search the world for the people you love. So be with us today and in days to come. Amen.
I invite you to join me in prayer, first silently, that you might say your own prayers, and then I'll lead us in prayer. Please, won't you pray with me? Great, good, and gracious God, we thank you for your presence with us, as you promised your people so long ago through Joshua. We are thankful for your continuous presence as Jesus promised to be with us always. Lord God, we need your healing presence and strength, for we live in turbulent and troublesome times. In our land, we overlook a precipice of polarization, hatred, and violence. And yet in Christ Jesus, we live on the edge of hope and promise. Lead us into hope and promise in better days. Gracious God, we need your healing, wholeness, and power to pervade us, our society, and world to be faithful in these days. We pray for our world and nation, our cities and communities, and churches for wise leadership to prevail and appear. We ask for thoughtful dialogue, principled actions to solve the vexing problems of our day and time. We ask for you to bring justice where there is unfairness and for reconciliation where there is divisiveness. We pray for productive discussions in the midst of deep, deep dilemmas and discord. Lord God, hear our prayers, our cry for our churches and a better society and world. Push back the darkness and bring the dawn of your light, grace, and hope. We give you all the praise, honor, and glory, O God. We make this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let us conclude our worship in song.
Out of the shadow. you gave me a song of revival. I put it on vinyl. Still rolling stones. Oh, you're still rolling.